You can set up Kafka and play with Kafka. Okay, little bit of Kafka also will be there. And then I will switch to the Go, where we will use Go client for Kafka to interact with the Kafka. Okay, and then we will just see the other stuff around that things. So this is also like a learning experience for me. The thing is that I will just try to go in a step which has allowed me to explore the topic, and which will allow you to because Kafka is a huge thing, right? So like completing this session or completing 10 other sessions, once you go out of this, still like there is 100 more sessions to be done. So rather like it's like how to go ahead, that also you may find it. So essentially like okay, this is one of the, there is something called Learning Journal. This is the YouTube channel where I have actually found one good series of Kafka. From there, I have actually learned. And this is one of the slides from that. So Kafka is just in this particular things, if you see. So there is something called Kafka cluster. Okay. And then there is brokers. There is zookeeper. There is producer and there is consumer. Okay. So this is mainly about dealing with the data. So this Kafka cluster takes care of data. Okay, data platform sort of things. There are so many ways to describe Kafka, but it's mainly like dealing with the data. the data it actually get from the producers, and then there are consumers. So it's like just providing a channel, like a message bus, messaging queue. Fine, again, we know there are like ActiveMQ and all that things that also like allow you to do the exchange of the data messages, okay, in asynchronous format and all that things. That use case also it supports, and on top of that it supports more use cases also. Kafka is a distributed system, so distributed means there will be multiple instances running, right? So that it will provide you like scalability and fault tolerance. So this broker one, broker two is nothing but the Kafka instances. So one broker equals one Kafka server, and three Kafka broker is there means three Kafka broker work together to provide you the distributed nature, availability, high availability, fault tolerance, scalability, etc. things. And it is very common setup. You will not have a Kafka with one broker, okay, generally, because then you will never get the reliability sort of things and high availability and all, right? And there is something called ZooKeeper. So this ZooKeeper is nothing but like this cluster management things. So it has knowledge of all these brokers and some metadata, so that this cluster is become a one total, kind, something like that. And then this producer and consumer, so these are like a, okay, so in BookMyShow, okay, like they want to see that how many ticket are booked, right? So they will the booking information will go in one place, but the number of booking happening, okay, may come to, so one of the producer will be there and it will feed the data. And then there will be consumer which will be acting upon they will come with a metrics saying that how many booking is happening in a given Diwali time, maybe more and more kind of things. So okay, fine. So basically we need to have a Kafka and ZooKeeper, okay? So now if you, I will be running the stuff on my local laptop, fine. So I always find that this Docker is a better way of doing all these things, because if you install F1, F2, like server 1, server 2, all that things, and start them, it is tricky and it requires a lot of configuration. And also like you need to do it always, multiple times. So Docker is a nicer way of doing that things. So I just found this Docker compose file. So it is taking some images for a ZooKeeper, okay, and it is exposing as a 21.2.1.8.1 port. Then there is a Kafka, there is an image for Kafka, it is exposing on 9.0.9.2, and there are some properties you can see. So this is how it is. Kafka is actually this is the IP address of the Docker host. So when you start Docker on your machine, it will also get another IP other than the local host IP. This is that IP. And as we see in this slide, that the broker, all brokers should actually report to the ZooKeeper, okay? So here, when a Kafka instance started, it will connect to the ZooKeeper and it will tell that, okay, I'm there, right? So the ZooKeeper understand, okay, there is a broker one coming to the picture. And this is like where actually the data gets stored when the Kafka is running certain things. So with this particular one, if you just start this Docker compose file, it will actually set up you these things, whole things, with a broker one. And it is like so easy, fine. And you can start using it right away, fine. So let me do that things first. So I have this Docker compose file which I was showing you, right? And just I need to say Docker ps. Okay, there are some instances running, so let me kill them so that we will start with the one which we have. So now if you see, there is nothing running for a Docker, right? So let's start with this Docker compose. you can say up and you will say hyphen D. It will detach the this particular cell so that the things will run in the background. So it is saying that there are two processes or the two server is actually started. So if you say, then you will get this zookeeper and Kafka is running. So that's it. Now your Kafka server is running on your local machine and you can actually use as if it is you are using in a production, right? So I'm just trying to connect to my Kafka instance. So this is how, these are the things I'm going to share in the one of the readme file, which I'm going to share on the GitHub. So everything will be available in the GitHub. So don't bother of writing, just try to follow it. So Docker exe it, and then to which I want to, so this is the Kafka process where I want to connect, and then I want to use this particular. So I have now connected to Kafka server, okay, on the Linux prompt, okay. So now this is the first step of setting up Kafka in your machine. Now second step, how to interact with the Kafka. So you just write Kafka and you just say, okay, they will give you the option, okay. You just pay, press a tab and it will give you an option. So Kafka. So these are the options available. So these are their commands available. So you will understand this little bit, but it is very like self-driving. So say for example, I see that there is something called Kafka tokens. So I will just say Kafka tokens.sh. So it will tell me that, okay, there are some arguments missing which you have not provided. So for running Kafka tokens, you can actually go with this particular create, delete, describe kind of things. So there is something called list which I can do. I want to list the topic. It is still say that, okay, there is something missing, which is a bootstrap server, okay, or a zookeeper. So you need to tell the server IP, fine, server location. So if you give it to the zookeeper location, zookeeper knows the broker, so it is enough. So let me just give the zookeeper location now, which is nothing but the local host and 2181. So again, you give something and again, it will be having some problem. So it is not showing anything. So because there are no topics currently available, so we are able to connect. And it is not listing anything. There are no topic to there. So topic I will come to there, but let's create one topic first, right? So just change this command to say create. And now it will tell you that, okay, you can't create a topic without giving a topic name, right? So topic is required. Cool. So let's give a topic. So it's a test topic, just a string name, right? So it will still say that, okay, there is something still missing. There is something called partitions, okay? So let me give the partitions. Okay, I will just give one for now. They are still saying there is something missing, which is replication factor, okay? And I will give the replication factor. Okay, so I will give one as a replication factor now, and I will, so it is created the test topic, fine? And now if you do the list, it will show you that there is a topic created. Now coming back to this particular, what are the parameters we specify? So first of all, what is topic? Topic is like one name of a data set you are dealing with, right? So if you decided that you want to record, like this is my understanding, right? So if you decided that I want to record all these click streams, which is happening from Book My Show, then I will go with one click kind of topic, fine. So I will just capture all the click, and click will be having type, whether it is search, whether it is book, whether it is something else kind of things, fine. So topic is like one data set which you are taking. Maybe you can say table also in a way, fine. And partitions. So after topic name, there is something called partitions. So you see that there are brokers exist, fine. So this Kafka is for a very large data set. So if you say that, okay, I have a topic for a click data, click stream data, but that is going way beyond, the data is going way beyond one particular server, one particular broker. Okay. So if you provide a partitions, so it will put one partition on one broker, another partition on broker two. So in that way, you can actually have more data. It's like horizontal scalability you will achieve, but Kafka works on the partition level. So if you have one partition, it will be always having mappings with one broker. So if you want that your data will go beyond the five broker, then you should have at least five partitions for your data. Okay, and then there is a replication factor. So say for example, let me try with another topic. Test topic, and then this is called, let me try this one, equal to demo topic, fine. But I want a replication factor equal to 2. Okay. So there is some error. So it is saying that replication factor 2 is larger than the available broker. So I'm only running one broker. And when I say replication factor equal to 2, what does it mean? That if you say 2, then your data will be duplicated into 2 broker, all the data. But that is not possible because you don't have a 2 broker. So if you have a 2 broker, you can go with a replication factor of 2. Okay. We can actually add more Kafka broker, but in this particular setup, only one Kafka broker is there and one zookeeper is there. So this is where we have created the topic. All good? Cool? So let's go to the next. Now, let's see what are the other stuff. See, you see that like we are just learning very easily. They are telling us what to do. There are some concepts which we need to learn. So this is Kafka and there is something called console. So there is something called producer and consumer, fine. So they have provided console producer and console consumer. So it's like instead of Book My Show, which is sending a data, there is a console which will be producing a data. And there is a console which will be consuming a data. So the app which we were talking is console in this case. So they have this console. So there is console consumer and console producer, right? So let's start with the console producer because first we need to produce the data, then we can consume the data. So again, they will say, okay, there is some problem, which is nothing but the zookeeper, we can say. It will keep telling you what is missing, because you want to, zookeeper is not an option here. So basically you need to say the bootstrap server. This is nothing but your broker list, right? So when you are actually doing this topic creation and all, you can do via zookeeper, because that is handled at the cluster level. But when you are actually sending data, you need to send it directly to the broker and not to the zookeeper, right? Because that indirection is not making sense. So that's why they are saying that this is real bootstrap server. Okay, they have something, okay. Not this broker list is the one. And then they are saying that, okay, which topic you want to, so test topic is the one which we created. So this is ready, fine. So my producer, which is a console producer, is ready to send the data to the Kafka. And now let me just start another one. So I will again start Dr. EXEIT. So because I want two command prompt, I'm starting another command prompt with this particular way. So I have again connected to the same Docker, but with another command prompt. And I will be starting here my Kafka consumer, but console. Okay, same strategy, I don't know. So they will tell what is missing. So actually here there is a concept of bootstrap server. same thing, localhost 9290 1982, right? Again they will say, so let me directly now copy the stuff which I have, which is this code, and the topic is our test topic.
Okay,
so let's not waste time for everything. So here the my consumer is started. So let me just first see, I'm sending one message and that message is coming. Okay, so this is happening with the same thing which is shown in this particular diagram, right? So there is on the left hand side, producer is a console producer. I sent MST1, then it went to a topic on the Kafka broker, and then it found that there is a consumer listening for this particular topic and it has given that particular message. So this is how the exchange is happening. The thing is that this will be asynchronous and this will be having like all this distributed nature, high availability and all the things it will provide. But we have not configured it yet because we have only one broker as of now. So message 2, and you can see there is something called from beginning. So it will start from the very first message. Okay, so if you now kill this guy and if you start, okay, now then what will be the output? It will give you message 1 and message 2, and if new message is coming then it will give that message 3. Okay, but if you start without this particular option, then it will not give you message 1, 2 and 3, but the one which is message 4 will come. Okay, so this is how, like, so this is the basic fundamental. I want to stop for Kafka. So Kafka, all these basic things, right? And now you can explore the option when you are like interested in more in Kafka. So you can just see there are so many commands available and each have their own specific use cases, right? So now let's go to the Golem part of the stuff, right? Any questions so far?
One question about Kafka. So you entered some message and it was consumed by Kafka. So what are the data types?
That's a good thing. I actually forgot to tell you. So basically Kafka says that when you are sending me a data, send me an array of bytes.
Serialized.
All bytes. It's like a binary bytes, nothing else. Yeah, everything will be like that. That's the message, right? Because inside that, what is there, it's not their problem. They just transfer data from producer to consumer. Now producer know that this is book my show order, and consumer know that this is
book my. Serialized by the producer and consumer.
Yes, but the data exchange will happen on the byte level. So when you are giving to the, so when we go to the Golem coding, we will see that we are actually sending the array of bytes and nothing else. And on the consumer also we are receiving, and then we can actually deserialize, serialize it, and all the things. But yeah, it's that's how it the data exchange format happens. Anything else? Cool. One last thing, like I will stop my producer, I will exit my consumer. So now let me just show one Kafka. So Kafka topics, and this is a zookeeper. And there is an option called describe. Okay, so it will describe the topic. Okay, so okay, just concentrate on this guy for now. Okay, so it will show that there are this topic called test topic. It has partition 1, replication factor 1. It shows that the partition 0, partition, there is only one partition, the partition ID is 0. There is something called leader, replicas, and ISR. I will come to these things later. So, but there is something which you can actually see. Let's now go with this particular example of. So now we are going to this. We are going to the Golem part. So now it's very simple thing. Fine, that any server which you are talking, you need a client. For a server means in every language, in multiple language you will get a different client. For Java you will get a different client, for Go you will get it different type. For C sharp you will get it differently. And in Go, for Go also you will get multiple clients, because there are multiple people providing a different client. So there are multiple Kafka clients are there. One of the Kafka clients which I am using in this particular example is from the Confluent team. So this is, there is a company called Confluent. They are using, they are providing Kafka as a service kind of things, and they have their Go client, and this is what I am using. So this Kafka Go client is actually a wrapper on the C client. So there is a Kafka C client called librd Kafka, something like that. Okay, so that particular client is returning C, and this Go client is just a wrapper. So it's like you will give, they will give a Go kind of API, but when you make a call to the Go API, it will make a call to the C client, and that C Kafka client will make a call to the Kafka server. So I have found that one of my friend who is working in Gojek, I asked that they are using Kafka and which Go client they are using, and this they are using. So in production people are using also. So I thought, okay, let me try with this client, because I was confused with which client I will try demo the stuff. So if you want to use this client, you need to install this libbird, librd Kafka, something like that. Okay, so this is the thing which you need to install, fine. So if it is not installed, it will having a problem, fine. So I already installed that things in the readme file. I will show you the steps and troubleshooting step for this. So once you install it, you can actually run this program. So let me first run this program. Okay, so it's start and end. So nothing we are doing, fine. So let me so there is something called config map. So this is where like we will provide the configuration, but first we want to create a producer, because we will produce a data, fine. So Kafka dot new producer. You see, this is the API, which is a Go API. That's why it's a Go client. But it requires a config map first. So we need to first create a config map. So in this config map, we need to give some property. So this is one of the property. Let me just put it here. So this is for producer. You just need to tell what are the bootstrap servers, and we have localhost 1982, and just provide this configures the things, and you will get the producer. So if error not is equal to nil, then we will just say panic, fine. Otherwise obviously we need to clear our resources, because this will be holding some HTTP connection, right? So it's very simple, fine. Even though you don't know Go, it's not a big deal. It's just like you want a producer, you will pass a config which will tell that which is the server. So this is a local host, but it can be any server, fine, in the world, with whatever the port. You will try to create this producer. If there is any error, we will stop the program. Otherwise we will make sure this defer will make sure that it will close the resources when the program exists. Okay, now let's just test whether this thing is fine. So it's working, it's fine. Okay, so now you need to actually come with this producer, and you need to go with this produce message. But before that, you need to send the so you need to produce a message, fine. So we will be creating a message equal to Kafka dot message. So if you want to create a message, you need to provide all these things. So which is nothing but topic equal to our topic name, which is our test topic. But let's try with the demo topic, because we have already done something there. So it will create also, even though demo topic is not there, it will create the one for us. And then set this something called partition equal to partition. I will come to this point later. but just go with the flow. Rest of the things we don't want to say.
Hello.
And this is where this key and value, which is
hey,
the
hi, can you share a screen too?
So I want a key is equal to, it will be always byte array. So MSG1 and value, this is the actual message. Okay. Byte. And this is hello. Go. Fine. And this is one, I'm going to use it here. Cool. So let me, so there is something called timestamp. So if you specify this timestamp, then a message when is stored with the Kafka, it will take, this is the creation time. Okay. So when you are sending whatever timestamp you set, it will become a creation time for that particular message. And if you don't set it, then when a Kafka receive it, it will actually attach a time that will become the creation time. Okay. And there are other things which I also don't know. So remove it and just say message. So this message will actually return you an error. They will return an error. And if there is an error, that's it. So this is like we are sending a message. That's it. Like same thing. Start a producer, send a message. And when you are sending a message, you need to tell which topic you want to send a message. And then there are partitions and everything, but we are not covering that as of now. And then just say that FMD, say no. Sending message and message sent. Okay, let's run it. Sending message and message sent. So hopefully the message should have reached it, but I'm not sure. So let's first write a consumer and see whether it is reached or not. Fine. So let's write a consumer now. So let me put this into demo producer. Okay. And I will be calling from here. Demo producer, but I already called it. Now let me start with the demo consumer. So similar things, we need to provide some config because that's how it will go ahead the stuff. And this is like little bit complicated. This little bit more config, but this is for consumer. So again, like bootstrap server from where the data will be fetched. There is something called group ID. I will come to that later. So let's put this one, auto commit, false, earliest, this is like start from the earliest. And there is something called offset, which is one of the important things from a Kafka perspective. I will come to that later. But let's start and go ahead with the Kafka, new consumer, and pass this config. Same thing, either they will give consumer or error, and just say if error not is equal to me. Or then otherwise you can say consumer dot read message, and then there is a timeout, and I will just put timeout -1, which is infinite. And if it is reading a message, then you will get a message or error. Error not is equal to new. Otherwise, effective print timeout. Message received, MSG is modulo V. Make sense? Okay, so let's run this guy. So now you know that I have just calling this consumer, okay, and not the producer. So hopefully the message which we have written should be read. So it means that that is not written correctly. So let's try to run producer. So this is one of the things which we need to. So after when you writing a message, you need to do a plus. Producer dot plus, and while flushing you will wait for some time, which is okay. Let's wait for two seconds, okay, and hopefully this will work. Okay, so now we are doing both, right? We are producing also and we are consuming also, and hopefully everything will happen one by one. So let me just put this one. So let's see here, Kafka topics, zookeeper, at least demo topic has been created. So now what is the thing which I'm missing? Now let me just see my example which I did it before. No, this is what I've missed. Because in the consumer, we have no information of where we are actually reading from. So there is something called this thing. In the consumer, we need to say demo topic. Okay? This is what we are missing. So now let's run this, but this time I will not produce anything and I will just try to consume it, and hopefully we will be able to consume. Yeah. So we have got some message. The message is not printed very well, so let me just print it more stuff on this one. So MSD dot topic partitions. So key. Okay. So what is the key? Is equal to modulo s, and this we know that we need to convert into string, and then string message dot value. Okay. And let's print it value. So let's run it. So again, consumer, same message we are going to read, but we are printing more information. So message one and hello go. Okay, so this is like how you will do go stuff. Now I will come to the things which we have set it in the consumer, and so there is something called group ID. Okay, so see, if you see this slide, there are consumers, right? So there will be multiple consumers. Okay, and the consumer will be actually forming a group, and then they need to give a group ID. So you can start a five consumer. Okay, you can start like a five go routines, which is actually having running one consumer, and everyone will be having group ID same. So if that is the case, then from the same topic, okay, they will be consuming all five all together. So it is like you will doing like if there are a lot of data is coming, like BookMyShow is sending a lot of data, because like there are 1 lakh customer which will be interacting with BookMyShow, and one consumer is not enough. So you will put five consumer to get the data, process it in a nicer way. and you will use this group ID to have five consumer running on the same data. But then there is a problem that whether this data, there is a possibility that two consumer will get the same data, right? Then Kafka is actually making sure that it will never happen. How? It is like they have mapping between partition and consumer. So if you have one partition, you can have one consumer, which is a ideal situation. If you put two consumer also, then one consumer will be idle and another consumer, only one consumer will be grabbing the data. So if you really want a five consumer to have effect, you should have at least five partition. You can have 10 partition and then five consumer, they both all will be getting the data from two partitions. And Kafka will make sure that in Kafka, when you're sending a message, you need to tell what is the partition. You see, when you say produce, demo producer, when you are sending a message, you need to tell which is the partition. Here, partition any. So the frame, the Go client will decide which partition it will go, but you can actually specify the number also, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So if you specify the number in your partition when sending a message, it will go to that partition. And then there will be consumer which will be grabbing the data from that particular partition. So one message will be only consumed by one consumer, and we will achieve parallelism using adding more partition and also adding more consumer. You can have 10 partition and you can have 5 consumer, that is fine. But if you have 10, if you have 5 partition and if you have 10 consumer, then 5 consumer will be taking data from 5 partition, other 5 will be idle. Okay. So that is this particular property. So see, all this, now see, the magic is with, this is the whole architecture. Now, how this producer and consumer are interacting with the Kafka. So Kafka has the capabilities of replication factor, partitioning, okay? And you need to just tune your producer and consumer. So all this tuning happens using this config map, okay? So there are, you can just go to the documentation of Kafka and you will just find what are the all properties available and how you can set it. So if you are Go via Go client, whichever the Go client you go, use their documentation, because they will be having some properties which is specific to their Go client, okay, as well as the one which Kafka is providing. Okay, I'm just talking, but hope it is like you guys can follow it, right? I generally don't prefer that way of just talking. I just like use some different way. That's why we are having code. Now enable auto commit. Okay. And then these things. Now let me just try what is this, all these things. So Kafka topics, I told you that there is something called describe. Okay, so now let's just understand these things. There is more things which is coming. List, describe, create, alter, delete. Okay, so basically I wanted to, so they have, okay, this is also again going with the Kafka stuff only. So let me just try. Okay, so I'm now talking about this particular property of offset. Okay, so offset is nothing but like if you have message one, okay, message 2, message 3, then you have 0 as the index for that message, 1 is the index and 2 is the index. Okay, so because see, it's like that the consumer once has read these things, okay, and next time they are asking, they want the next message, next set of message. Now it may be possible that the consumer died and again we restart it, See, in our case, whenever we are restarting, it is starting with this message, which is already read. Okay. But in the real life, we don't want that the consumer which restart should actually read all the messages, right? So if you want to make sure that it will not read all the message, then this there is something called commit. You need to actually do that. This is like a consumer, I think so. You can put commit. So you will say commit. Once you say commit, whatever the message which you have read, Kafka knows that the consumer has read those messages. And if the next time the consumer is coming, it will start from the one which it is left for. Okay. Now, this is because I made it auto commit equal to false. But if you make it auto commit true, which is by default, it means that if you don't specify a property once, okay. And let me now run my consumer. So I'm running my consumer only. Only change I made it, I have removed this property, which was before false. It was false in our previous run. So now let me run it. So it has received the message. Now let me run once again. And now this is not getting any message. Why? Because there was an auto commit true by default. Right? I think this earliest is actually making these things also. No, no, maybe we have written two messages by chance, right? Because we have run our producer multiple times, so let's run once more.
By default, it might be taking false, right?
No, by default, it is true. So let's see what is there in this by running the console consumer, okay? And then they require bootstrap server. 1992 and topic is our demo topic and from right. Okay, it has one only message, so it has only one message, but we are able to read it multiple times. Why? Because maybe this is the one. This is auto offset reset earliest, so it will start from offset earliest.
That is equal to beginning, right? Yeah. So if you are in the command line, you are telling it from beginning. So earliest from the configuration, it seems like this is you are telling read from the beginning.
Yeah. So I have actually need to check these things offline, but you got the idea, fine. Yeah, we already consumed. See, now it's not now it's not producing. Yeah, that's what we are trying. But I thought that only this disabling this property will do. But I need to disable this property also. And I think so. Let me try. So it's not getting it. No, it's getting it. So I think this property also should not be there. And then it will actually try to get these things. So actually,
we can explore it ourselves.
Yeah.
Maybe you can explore it ourselves. Actually, we put in a loop, it will not consume.
No, no.
Every time we are resetting that.
No, no. See, we wanted a situation when once consumer received, if it is trying for the same topic, it will never take the same message which was.
We can seek it.
Yeah, that's what we are seeking. It maybe here, and this we are disabling the seeking. But we need to do R&D, try and error on this. But overall, you get the idea, fine. So these are the things I wanted to cover. Anything like. So now there are some more things. Let's do it. We have some time. Let's try to do it with respect to Go. Some more Go stuff, right? So say for example, when you are sending a message, okay, let me enable my producer. Let's just go with this kind. just forget rest of the things now, and let me delete this guy also, fine. So Kafka, okay. Topics zookeeper, delete topic demo. Okay, let's not delete it. Let's try with another demo, which demo two topic, fine. I want a fresh stuff, that's why I'm booking. So in the producer, see, this is asynchronous producer, fine. It has just sent a message and it does not know that whether the message was delivered or not. And if you want to see whether the message is actually delivered, then how you will achieve that, fine. So then there is a callback mechanism also available, which is how you will do here. So after sending a message, okay, message sent. So now this message sent, we will run it here. Okay. So what in this is happening in producer. So in producer, when I send a message, this is my producer message. It is asynchronous. I like send it, but I don't know that whether it is delivered to the Kafka. It may be possible that the Kafka server is down and it has not reached it. Then how to know that things? Then there is something called, you can actually probe it. So there is something called producer.events, which will return you a Go channel. And on that Go channel, you can actually say, okay, give me the next item on this particular channel. So if you send one message, it will give you one item, which is a one event. And then that event, you can actually see whether there is error or there is no error. If there is no error, then message is 100% delivered. Otherwise, there is an error. Okay. So let's just run this. And once it is delivered, produced, we will also consume it. Now we have changed our demo to topic. So obviously, we will start afresh everything. Right? So let's run this guy. So we are sending a message. Try to receive a message. And this is things message deliver successfully. It is coming from here, you see. Message deliver successfully. So they have got this event, okay, and then they know that, okay, this is worked correctly. I have not tried this, but let me make this way, fine. And let's run this guy. Let's run only producer, fine. Hope you are following. If no, then let me know. I will, okay. See, you have sent the message, but ideally we should, okay, because I think there is a problem with this. I have not tried this scenario, so let me not try R&D here. But you got the point, fine. This was about like getting the confirmation, callback mechanism, fine. Similarly, so ideally in the real life, you will run one Go routines, okay. For this one, you will run a Go routines. It's like the way this guy told, fine. There will be a for loop, okay, which will be keep sending a message. Okay, let's do that and conclude our stuff. We don't have more time, so let's just put this also here. Means I think you got it. I don't need to do it. Fine. You will be doing like this. You will be sending, keep sending a message. Okay, then on this particular event channel. So this is you will be doing for, and then you will be having range, okay, and then you will keep receiving the events. Obviously, you will be doing this in a separate Go routines. So you will keep sending a message, and then there is a loop which is running, which will be keep receiving a confirmation callback and saying, okay, it is done. And similarly, on the consumer side also, you will be running some loop, which will be like here. And you will be keep reading a message. Means I can make these things complete, but it's not a big deal to do, fine. Because if there is a time of 5 minutes, I want to cover another. No, it's 11. 5 minutes more.
Regarding the other topic, there is an issue that you are reading the same message. So I just read the docs. So auto commit interval is default 5 seconds.
Yes.
Your application is inserting before 5 seconds. So
that is why it is not committed. Yes, so I don't need to try that. So this auto commit is by default true.
By default true.
But a second, every five seconds it will do a commit. Because it's not like that every message it will say commit, commit, commit. Because it will be overhead of committing.
As part of our course also we could commit. As part of the course.
No. Code.
Produce a
consumer
close, right?
Close is there, but not as part of close it will do commit. Yes. That's what you are saying. Yeah. But leave it, there is exercise, we can try it out later.
Yes,
right?
Definitely.
Okay, but so the idea is there, these things exist. These are very like, see, if I want to tell, then these are the main concept of Kafka stuff, which we try to cover. Producer, no need to tell. Consumer, no need to tell. Broker is a Kafka broker. Cluster is a Kafka cluster. Topic, know very well. Partitions, right? Offset. Offset is this, where from where you want to start, right? Message 1, message 2, and there will be 0, 1, 2, 3 index. And then consumer groups. Okay? Consumer groups also, like I explained. If these are the fundamental architectural concepts, semantics, okay? And now you need to play with them. We will change the property of here and there. You will make multiple broker. Okay. Multiple broker I can do right away within 5 minutes with a broker. But yeah. Any other question? Okay.
So if the event is lost or message is lost, we are receiving that on the channel. Right?
Yes.
So how will we resend it?
Retry.
But like, we are in another routine which gets a message. It has been lost, something like that.
I think there is in this producer, when you go configure these things, they also have a auto retry things. So when a message is actually there, when you say produce, okay, it will give a try. Say for example, it understands that there is a temporary issue and the server is not there. Okay. Then this produce itself inside will try once, twice, thrice, depending on the configuration you should say. And even though it is not working out, then only it will throw an error for this particular event. So once you get the error, it is unlikely that you will, it is not a recoverable error mostly, right? Because if it is a recoverable error, then I think this produce will take care, the client will take care. Client is like, because that property will be there, like how many retry you want to do, what is the gap between the retry. So it's not like that the server is down, okay, and you are keep retrying every 5 milliseconds. So you say, okay, if there is a problem, wait for 1 second and do a retry. Those sort of properties also will be there.
So that event would consist of these properties that which message has failed, so that we could handle that. This one. So let us suppose some message failed after multiple retries, so we get a event in the channel that this failed.
Yes.
So that event should have all the properties, right? That this message was not taken.
Yeah, here it is there. See,
there is there.
Yeah. It will tell everything. That what is the error, first of all it will say, and you need to see what is, they have all these things, okay, what was the topic, what was the partitions, okay, but yeah, so that's it from my side. Any other question?
Thank you.
Sharing my screen. Do you want me to unmute?
Yeah, you can unmute.
You should make yourself unmute.
Yes. So thanks Noor Ali for the first talk. So second talk, this is with the hands-on with gRPC and Protobuf. So how many of you have worked with gRPC and Protobuf before? Nice. So I will be learning from you guys today. So a bit about me. Who am I? I'm a developer at SAP Lab India. I do Go and Node.js development basically. And you can find me at, if you have any question, you can find me actively on Twitter. I do share some links also about performance related activities with the Go. And you can find more information about me at my site. What we will be talking about today? Let's think about agenda. We will have serialization, we will have prototype basic, we will have one example where we will try to code a protobuf, and then we have what is gRPC, and we will go through what are the gRPC, some gRPC examples. First of all, why we need protobuf, right? Protobuf means any serialization at all. Let's think this way, means because every problem, means every solutions that you have, it's there to solve some sort of problem. What was the problem? At a fundamental level, what does machine means computer operates on? Binary, 0 and 1. If I give you 0 and 1, means let's suppose I have written your name in 0 and 1 or his name, and I give you that and I tell you, it's up to you to decipher what it is. Can you decipher it? No, right? So to decipher it, you need some sort of information attached to it. Metadata or any sort of information what it is actually. You cannot, means 0 and 1 can be integer, 0 and 1 can be string, 0 and 1 can be anything. So for that you need some, so higher programming language came with the notion of type. You'd say, okay, this is integer, it's a, I know this is integer, now you can figure it out. This is a string and so on. But can you transport the same thing to over the wire? No, right? Because every programming language has their own way to represent these types. So that's why we came with the serialization. It's like a standard, having a standard that all across the all platform can understand what we need, means what this data means, and how to deserialize it, and so that I can understand it. So there are various serialization mechanisms, JSON, XML, binary, there are a few more. First of all, serialize, because most of the time when we do with serializing of data, we are basically concerned with sending it over the wire or over the network. So when you, how many of you have designed cache set system? Awesome. So what is the first thing you do with the cache? Means serialize and deserialize. The first thing is what is your cache size, because with the cache you want to make it as fast as you can. And if your cache size, let's suppose I have a cache size where I am storing more than 1500 bytes, why it should be a first flag point? Because if you are storing more than 1500 bytes, your Ethernet means, because if I'm designing that cache for consumers, my Ethernet cannot, means the maximum in one network size, means one network, I can send 1500 bytes because it's limited by the MTU. So if you are designing cache for the consumer and you want it to be, you know, the cache should be fetched within one network cycle itself, means within, it should not make multiple network call, you should be taking care of this thing, what you are storing in the cache. So with that, we know that serialized data should be minimum so that we can have a faster communication. Here we have a Go type system. In the Go type system, we have a 1K request. What is 1K request? We have just an ID with integer 64, and we have a data, means it's not a good way to design, it's for you to understand. Data of 1024 bytes. So it is 1 kilobyte request, right? So 1 kilobyte, let's see, means because it will not have any padding on my 64-bit system or even on the 32-bit system, because all the memory are aligned over here with the 8-byte and this 1024-byte. What we have, if we do the size, we have 1032 bytes. What do you think the size of this would be in JSON or XML if I serialize it? Okay, let's go into the JSON. I serialized within the JSON, what is the length I get? 2069. So even for 1032 bytes of data, you have the double the size. So if this data is almost triple or four when you have a large data set. So you're getting the point, right? Same data when you represent in the binary means in programming language, you are getting it in less than one, means around 1 kilobyte. When you are representing it in a JSON, you are getting it up to 0.69 byte. That means if I have to send the same data over the network, I have to make two network calls to send this data. XML, old folks. Sorry, no offense. 3125 bytes. Even more. So what is happening over here? With JSON, we are able to achieve in two network call with XML 3 because 1500 with TCP header and all, you are not actually sending total 1500, you are sending less because 20 bytes of TCP header and all. So you have three network calls. This is with the protobuf 1030 byte. One network call, right? So what it's happening is not important. Right now you can see that with the faster serialization, means the protobuf is doing the serialization smaller. The first criteria, we get the smaller serialization. It's faster or not, that's the another point of topic of discussion. You can benchmark it. But the main point was we have the smaller serialized data.
Where 2 byte is reduced?
You have to check in the serialization. So basically, if you look over here, 2 byte, basically you see that 1 and 2 number, right? They don't actually store that it's integer or they actually send the data with the number. The other consumer who has the same proto spec, means you give them the proto spec, they can consume and deduct the data based on the number. So if you have any protobuf system where you want to send data, make sure you don't change the assigned field number 1 and 2 for once you have defined the field. So this is basically where I think they are reducing the number. I'm not pretty much sure. I have to figure it out. Means how they, means it's like going into their implementation details. So what is protobuf? So protobuf are Google neutral, platform neutral extensible mapping for serialized structured data. So the point over here is structured data. You should know the structure of your data. It's not that we do in the dynamic, we sending any JSON value and it's up. So you should know what is the structure of your data in advance. Why? It's smaller. Think XML, but it's smaller. We have already seen it's smaller. Faster? Yes, it's definitely faster because the serialization and direct serialization does not have to care about lots of information that we do with the JSON parsing. Like string value, key value, it knows the type already. It does not have to typecast into that again to the string. Because in dynamic programming language, you do typecasting at the runtime. It's simpler, that's something they say, but I know most of us are so, accustomed to JSON. That is something it's a point of view from a different person. So there are two aspects of it. First, you need to install. So if you are installing, means trying to work with protobuf, you need to install proto compiler. Compiler is what generates your code for the use PB file, the protobuf file, and runtime installation. This runtime installation is something you do for your programming language. How do you want to consume this protobuf file and make use of it? There are some alternatives to it. I hope you have seen that lots of these days flat buffers are making lots of noise with the Dino community, and means flat buffers, they say it's even faster than the protobuf. The size may differ, but serialization and deserialization is even faster. If you look into CAP and proto, they even claim the same. So you might want to check these out, but the Thrift is a RPC framework altogether, right? It's not only serialization, it's a complete RPC framework as far as I'm aware of. Yes. So with the Thrift, you can compare with the gRPC, not with the serialization and deserialization alone. Yes. Huh, that you can compare. No, yes. You can use it with the HTTP also. You can use with the command line. There is no way only you can use it with gRPC. Even gRPC is not completely tied with the protocol. You can, with the gRPC, you can all use all this. If this compiler supports the generation of the gRPC services, actually flat buffer support, so you can utilize the gRPC with flat buffers. Okay, so first of all, what we need to do with the protoverb to use it? We need to define a message. What is message? So the first point is you need to say with the syntax, right? So this syntax is, it's proto 3. There are various versioning of proto buff also, proto 2, proto 3. So with that, I'm saying it's a proto 3 format. Package, you can omit it, but for, let's say package name is where you define, so this goes into this package. It's good to have this segregation. It's more of a namespace concept. Now here is the person. I have a string, I have a is, I have a email. I define name and string of email, and then integer of age. And then I can use the proto C. If I have installed the proto compiler, I will use the source directory. If you want this to be compiled from some source directory, what if go out of the means plugin, I want this to be compiled in the Go file, because this proto C file is neutral, language, not language specific, right? I want this to be converted into my language specific, from where I can consume this. So that's why the go out destination directory is where you want this file to be generated, BV file, and this source means from where this file should be compiled. And then use the go buffer API to consume this proto file. Now what is this message? Now if I have to represent this person information, we all have been told, right? In classical object-oriented way, does not matter how messy it is, inheritance. We define a person, we say, okay, we want to model a person, object-oriented. We define a class person and we represent all this name and field value. That's how you actually compose higher type from the primitive type that any programming language provides. It's like composing. Does not matter. This is in the JavaScript, but even in the Java, you have a string type, you have integer type. How do you model your code? You model from primitive types. So when you say class, class is nothing but the type. You define your own custom type. Means it's provide you way to define your own custom type inside the programming language. So with the type system, Go has the different syntax. Go provides you with a type with the named type. You define a name type with a person and struct. It's like composing a new type from the all the primitive type that the type means programming language supports. So this is how you define in Go or in the object-oriented way. What is the way of doing in the protobuf? This is how you do in the protobuf. You define a person. You model a real-world object with the message. So there we have a syntax class. In Go, we have a named type, and then some name. In protobuf, we have something known as the syntax as message. So this is the message of the aggregation of the type field. So you see, string, unsigned integer, 32 string, these all are primitive types already provided by the proto-C compiler. So you can model your, assemble this primitive types and model your real-world examples. So that's what message contains. There are other bool 32 into float. Just check out the doc for all the scalar values and as well as the vector values also it supports. So vector values is where you have the, so vector in mathematics is basically where you have the magnitude as well as like dimension, because in computer science it's more of the attached with the size and values. So you have the size attached and then magnitude means size, and then the direct is all the values that is there. the one important point. Each field in the message definition has a unique number.
You see, string name has the unique number of 1. You
have the age of 1, unique number 2. You have this email of unique number 3.
Why this matters? Because these fields numbers are the actual, as I have already said, are the actual numbers that are used to identify during serialization and deserialization. There is no information if it is integer or unsigned integer 32 or a string of email. These numbers shortens your serialization size. So these numbers are really important, but means how much important display. So there are other caveats also around this. If you have a message format that needs more than 15, means if this field number exceeds more than 15, you pay penalty. We'll see. So if we have a number 1 to 15, it takes only 1 byte to encode, including the field number and the field type. But if you assign that an integer 64 to be 16, it will take 2 byte to encode that. I know for it should not matter in most of the cases, but when you are doing real hard time system, it is every byte counts, right? That's what most of the time people suffer from when doing performance analysis, where exactly because for every byte you do garbage collection and all those stuffs. So if you see 1032 byte, I change this to 17, I got 1031 byte in the Marshall format. So for when I change it to the field number to greater than 15, the 1 byte has increased. It's, you can verify things. There is no it's there and I can, okay, it's there, I can just go, okay, I have some. You can actually go ahead and verify things. Let's see one demo of the protobuf now. Do you have any question till now? Okay, what I will be doing is, I have a simple code that flag.parse is nothing but it parses the flag argument, whatever I will be passing over to the command line from the command line. And then based on the action, it will say if the action is add, just add whatever I am passing to it. And if it's list, just list whatever is there. So what is this doing? Actually, I have a file that is person.db, where if I pass this add, I am passing person name, the data we saw, right? I'm passing the person name, age, and email ID, and it will be stored as the DB, inside the DB, in the serialized protobuf serialized format. But those who have worked with the DB, there is one caveat, right? You don't know how much to read. You don't know how much to write. So what you need to store for most of the DB, those who have written DB at the level, they store the total number of byte before they want to read. Means there is a byte, number of byte that needs to be written and that has been given, and it's stored also. Like before this new data begins, this is the number of byte I want to read from this point to next. Till next point. So that's what I'm doing, because this is the binary little Indian system. I'm just storing that for each. So here is the add command. I have a person.proto file, the same string, name, age, and email. So I need to compile it to use it, right? So I have a person.proto and I don't need gRPC right now, so this is the command. I have a proto C compiler already installed. I will see that this person.proto in this folder, current folder, compile and give me the output in the Go format. So once I do in the Go format, what I get is the pv.file. You should not be editing this file. So here you see that person form, the person type is represented as the Go type. It has a name, age, email, and these are the field that Go generates, means Go protocol generates for the runtime to check for the marshalling and unmarshalling. So how could I use this? Here the same person db dot person, I install means argument 0 becomes name. I am not validating anything, just this for the simplest purpose. Age and email, and all I do is proto.marshal with this p, whatever the person, and I will just marshal it. After marshalling it, I get a byte and I get an error. So this byte is what is your marshalled data is. So this byte is actually denotes what is the size of your serialized data is. So all I have to do is open the file in means create an append mode, and then I have first want to write how much data I'm storing for this request, because when reading from it, this becomes really important. So I store that length of the byte that I have in the whatever Indian format your architecture support. For me, it's Little Indian, so I will store in the Little Indian format, and then I will write after that byte, I will write the simple whatever byte serialized data is, and I will close this file. Let's go and write this. I stored it, right? It got stored. Now if I have to read it, if I want to read from my DB what are the things that has been stored, that means I want to get the list of all the add atom that has been performed. So what goes while we do the reading? So we have the list command. It goes like this. We read the, open the file for reading, and we, because it's a small, for here we are not doing any seek operation or what, we are reading everything inside the memory. Then what we get a byte array. From the byte array, till we have everything to read, we look inside it. And while looping inside it, we check the length of the byte array. What is the, and the size length. The size length over here is 8, because whenever we are doing the read operation, the size should be always greater than the 8, because the first byte, even for the blank file, what we are storing the length of, what is the byte length means the, when we are adding, what is the serialized size. So for that, this, we will have always the 8 byte on the 64 bit system. So here we are saying if it's less than 8, it's not properly formatted, nothing else. Then we read the length of the size. First we read byte from the size length. Length is, we read from the size 8 to get the size. What is the size I have the next, till the next serialized format from the, in the byte array I have to read to get the entire encoded or serialized data. And then from the size length till, here is the size length, and I get, I resize the slice, means byte array, I just resized it so that I read it from there until the length, whatever the length, let's suppose it's for this, if I get 1034 or 1024, whatever byte is, I read that and I unmarshal it to the person DB. And then I do the same operation again and again. You see, okay, so there was two already there, but if you see it, the last one is something that I stored just now. So this is how you deal with the, so with the protobuf, it does not say that you have to work with the gRPC only to utilize the protobuf. Actually, protobuf is used in most of the DB also nowadays. Have you heard, how many of you heard dgraph? It's a graph database. They actually do the protobuf serialization and deserialization to store their data. No, Aman is not there. He works for the dgraph. They, if you are interested, just check with him how they do this. So, Aman Mangal. He is not here. he was giving talk yesterday to someone, that's why he was not able to make it, but they usually come. So this is all about the protobuf we have till now. Now, any question for protobuf? Okay, so with that, now let's go to our second thing, RPC. So what is the benefit of RPC means over the plain HTTP, if we talk about in general, means what's your point of view?
You don't need to go till HTTP protocol.
You need to go, most of the framework.
No, but not in the HTTP. Because this is like language, RPC is language based, right? So
RPC is language.
No, when you have a Go data type, it will be directly you can convert from Go data.
No, it does not go through the Go data type. It actually serializes in language neutral way. What you get is a byte serialized format of the proto C. So it does not matter if it's serialized in Go or any programming language. Your producer can be in any language, consumer can be in any language. So it's the same thing with HTTP also. Your producer can be in any language, your consumer can be in any language. The main benefit with the RPC is the serialization format that we get, plus most of the RPC framework that we use nowadays uses HTTP 2. With the browser, it means HTTP 1, it's that you get multiplex of the same connection and all those benefit. WebSocket is also providing multiplex and all. So there are, means it's not pro and con or benefit, it's upon your use case, what you want to, what's your team is comfortable with. So it's like, you know, means it's nothing like you, I'm doing in HTTP, I should move to RPC. It's more of a, if you have a more structured data, you want this to be communicated, typed information, and all the teams should coherently, means stick to it, go for the RPC.
But this RPC works from the TCP connection, right? They don't need the HTTP connection.
So,
HTTP connection require TCP connection under this. But with RPC, you can directly start with the TCP connection.
Yes.
So HTTP will not come. That's what it is. It may be possible that people are using HTTP too, but without that, on a pure TCP connection, you can actually do RPC.
Yes.
So
I have a wide question here. RPC is a generic term. It's a reward procedure call. It was introduced a few decades ago. It's not a new term. It's been there for long time, and RPC basically means it's a remote process call, which you're calling a function on a remote system base. In HTTP, you don't call a function, you call an API. You call a different system, and in RPC, you call a function of a remote system, just like you're calling your local function. And it gives you back a structured data how your local system would give you. And that's, it might be a bit more complex than your local system, but very, very much close to your system. You can use it and directly translate it and use it.
Exactly.
RPC was within Microsoft was used heavily a couple of decades ago.
But
they made it very popular.
But this RPC will not go to HTTP layer. HTTP protocol,
RPC,
I guess so.
So RPC is a technique, right? So you have to remote procedure part. So with HTTP, basically it's an underlying architecture which you want to use. It does not stop you from using the underlying architecture.
Yes.
So depending on what framework you are using, in gRPC it uses HTTP 2. If you go to Corpa, if you go to IDE, Drift, so they will have their own implementations of how they connect, the client connects to the server.
Communication.
Yes.
The communication channels that the framework decides.
Yes.
So, it's basically a generic term.
Yes.
RPC is just a generic term.
Yeah. So, if you look into the RPC means definition, it clearly says a remote procedure call when a computer means execute in a different address space. What is different address space? I have a program running. If I have one program running, it runs its own virtual address space, right? If I have a second program running, it runs its different virtual address space. Now this virtual address space need not have to be in the same machine. It can be distributed across the globe. So how do you connect with these two different address space and still able to, you know, the program, as a programmer, you don't have to deal with the underlying type, like is it on the same machine or on the different machine? So that's where the RPC framework come in. It generates all these behind the scene stuff for you. So stuff is basically when clients try to interact and does not care about what's going on behind the scene, how I call this function on different address space over the network or within the IPC model on the same shared machine, does not matter to them. So this is what RPC basically means. You do not have to explicitly code the details of remote interaction. This is the main fundamental goal of all the RPC framework. I don't know, means how many of you have attended two-month talk back of mine. So if not, you can. I gave a talk on writing an RPC framework in three line of pure Go. Maybe you can check this out in the GitHub. It's all inside the GitHub. How do you write trying to write your own RPC framework? You can. You have all the details over here. I mean, not every complete details. So here, actually, for this RPC framework, I use the TCP protocol to just transmit the data. I didn't use HTTP or HTTP2. Over here, if you see, I just did the serialization with the transport with the Big Endian and this TLF format. So I tagged the length with the TCP, how much data I'm sending and all. You can check more details on this. It has all the RPC client basically generating the functions and this behind the scene stuff and calling this out. So you get the idea of what goes on behind the scene for the RPC. So we have this gRPC. Why we have the gRPC? It's again a high performance, open source, universal RPC framework. Like he mentioned, right? We have TRIP. There was some other name that also came for the RPC. So previously, I think in the Java also had RPC, remote procedure call something. In the Java world also, they have their own native RPC framework. So gRPC is basically, they are trying to portray it as a universal RPC framework, plus this also matured from the cloud native foundation. So Docker and all, most of the time Docker and all uses gRPC for their communication. So for gRPC, there are four things that needs to be done. A gRPC client application can directly call method on a server application on a different machine as if it was local object. That's the, yeah. Yes, language agnostic. So your server will be in the GR.
So as this had, so gRPC, RPC is language agnostic. gRPC you can negotiate it in anything. Protobuf makes it language agnostic. Because of Protobuf, it is language agnostic. gRPC makes it language independent because of Protobuf. That is what implementation matters.
When you have the same protobuf,
right? You can
compile it to
different languages. There is a concept of ideal interface. So Protobuf actually is kind of an extension to that. Creates an interface. The server implements that interface. Client consumes that interface.
So regarding your question that gRPC is language independent or not, any RPC framework, it's up to you to provide in as many languages as you want to make it language independent. For gRPC, let's suppose, what do you do when you consume gRPC? You import a library, right? You don't do anything. If that library is available in Java, you can use it inside Java. If that library is available inside the Haskell or any other Rust or Python or any other programming language, you can use it. So it's not that it's language independent, its language is there. Means the fundamental is if that library for that RPC is available in that programming language or not.
With Protopup, we can also create our own library, right? Because your Protopup is already available.
Yes.
And if we know the server address, we can create our own libraries if it is not available.
Obviously, it means if you have a Protopup, you want to instead of the JSON, you send the Protopup serialized data, and over the HTTP or over the TCP, and on the other side of the language, you receive that data, and you know this is the Protopup file. All I have to do is deserialize it. gRPC also does the same. You have to actually, it knows that this is the file in the Protopup file that is coming to me. All I need to deserialize it back to the Protopup file and get back the original data. So it does not matter. So when you have this pb.go file, it's in the Go language, right? It does not matter from where it came. It came from the Proto-C. You can use flat buffer also. All you get a again the pb file for the flat buffer. While deserializing, gRPC will deserialize to that pb file according to your data type. It does not matter it came from the protobuf or it came from the flat buffer. So that's how it becomes language agnostic. Language agnostic, it compiles to the language of your use. It does not provide that you have to utilize the other language in which I have written and then get back the data. It gives you the language, means all the data necessary file to work with in your own programming language that you are trying to implement this gRPC. So again, how do we define? Again, we are using this for the protobuf file only for this demo. You define a service in protofile. You generate a server and client code using the protobuf compiler, and you use the Go gRPC API to communicate with this file. Also, gRPC lets you define four kind of service method. Unary RPC, it's like a normal function call. You execute a function, you wait for the response came back, you are done. Streaming, server streaming RPC, these are the client streaming. So in server streaming RPC, server will continuously stream the value to the client. It's up to the client how they want to consume it. Client streaming RPC, here the client will constantly stream the data, or bidirectional streaming, in which both the client and server will stream the data. For our talk, we will only focus on the unary RPC. You can go to gRPC.io to find out what is the possibility with server streaming, client streaming, and the bidirectional streaming. So we have a service. So all these look same, right? For Protobuf. Apart from this, so we define a service, gRPC. With gRPC, we need to define a service. Service is basically a contract. Contract means it's an interface. You say for this gRPC means I'm defining a service of get user. With this get user, I want two functions to be executed, add and list. List will take a message of void. Message of void means I'm not providing any argument to it. Over here, nothing goes there. And I say that, and it returns a user. What is user? User is an array of user. So repeated means array. This is how you write an array in Proto-C file, in Proto-3 format. So these are the only things to add gRPC. The only thing you need to add is this service layer. But all this message user, we have already was there, right? When we were doing with the proto.go file. And I use the proto compiler to consume, generate the client and server code. The only thing I added was the plugin is gRPC. I want this plugin to be with the Proto-C, means compiler. You generate me the gRPC format of it. Because, yeah. Yes. Because, see, if you are not, the actual implementation vary from your use case also, your language also, your use case also.
I'm returning a message of void means
I'm not returning that match. There is nothing returned over here. In the gRPC, there is no concept of
void. No,
you might have seen there is a talk, null, a billion dollar mistake.
Yes.
Just check this out by the person who is mostly responsible for most of the computer science stuff. So if you look into this, the generated server, means this is the Go code, generated server. So generated server, there is the interface, list and add. You get a context API when you are doing HTTP, basically network call. You, the first argument is basically context API to do all those cancellation and all. Let's leave it for, if you are not aware what is context API in the Go interface in the Go, leave it. Then we have the void. This void is nothing but the message that we defined. That means it takes no argument, but it returns of user and error. Same for the error, add, it takes the user PV file, that user file that we have message type, and it returns void and error, if error has happened. What is this? Then you have a register get user server. Why we need to register this get user server means whatever get user server we have, that interface, right? We need to actually register it to the gRPC server, because gRPC server is unique, means it does not contain for, think this way. gRPC server, you are writing a framework, RPC framework. In advance, you do not know what's your use case and what is the user defined type that you are going to define, right? So to find, to for me to figure out what's the user defined type that you are defining, you need to provide me that user, means your all your user defined type at the time when you are registering this inside your server code, so that when any request comes based on this, if that, because of the method, if you look over here, the method call list and add, it will know for which user service I am, means for this method I've come, and indirectly call the actual implementation. So here is the creating server, because it has two method, interface has two method, list and add. I defined a user model, simple Go struct, that has nothing, and then implemented means right now it's returning nil and nil, but it I just implemented these two method. What this does is I in turn implemented the gRPC server, what was generated for me in the PV file, and this has been implemented over here. Now how do you create a server? You first import the gRPC. So this can be in your any programming language, right? You import the gRPC library, you get a new server out of gRPC, and then you register the server implementation. For me, the server implementation for this is get user services user model that implement this server over here. So I just implemented it, and I'm listening on the network 302 port, and just I'm serving from this. Any call coming to this port with this list and add method, if client is calling, it will simply call this implementation that I have done. You also get proto client interface for this. Proto compiler also generates the client stuff that we will see. So you also get the list and add method for the get user client. What are the gRPC options over here when calling the client? And this is the stuff generated. If you look over here, so this is generated by you for the Proto C compiler. You don't have to generate this. So if you closely look over here, all you do is for the client, you call the list method. Indirectly, it calls all the CC, gRPC connection dot invoke, and internally stuff, whatever stuff it has generated, it does all the calling for on your behalf. So this is the stuff that we were talking about. The implementation, how you interact with the you know, other memory addresses was concerned, you do not have to worry about this. This is taken care by all the RPC framework. So creating the client, it's again the same thing. You why I did with the gRPC, you can secure because with HTTP2 you need TLS certificates. On the local system, I do not have the I didn't want it to go with the TLS certificate for this demo. It can be confusing if you are starting, just getting started with this. So I did with the within secure. That means nothing. I am not providing any TLS certificate. I am okay with my connection. I trust it. And then I model new get user client with the connection. It returns the I get the client over there. And all I with the client. All I have to do is client.add, model.word, and client.get, client.list. If I call it, I am interacting as it is with the normal local function. All I am doing is a function call. So at this point of time when you are writing gRPC service, you are only doing this. All those stuff that for the client that I have just shown you, it was just for your understanding purpose that whatever you are doing means before that has been done was taken care by the all the products and the gRPC behind the scene. So you do not have to worry about that. We'll quickly look into the demo now. So if you look over here, we have the same model with the syntax protocy function of user void, get user list and add method. I will generate a proto. I generated the with the protocy file, and if you see over here, we have the get client user. All these files already generated for me. I do not have to. It's in the Go format. I do not have to worry about modifying it to get to use. All I need to import this pv.go file to my actual implementation and start working. Here is the server. If you look over here in the server, what was I was doing over there in the command line, I did the same inside here in the server. I have a user model with the list method. I just have this list method. It read everything from the person.dv file and just return back to the user. To this model.user, so that the thing that I was doing inside when I was doing in the command line, it can be achieved over the network also with the list, and the same thing for the add. In the here in the server, I did a gRPC and I registered my RPC implementation. So because this user model implement both list and add method, it implements the get user service over there, and then I am serving this. And within the client, I do the same. Instead of just calling the local function, I'm calling it through client.list. The only change I have to do is the client.list. I imported the client. I am doing client.list. I do not have to worry about if you see over there, all I'm doing is just making it sure I'm not calling it from the local function. I'm just calling client.list instead of the local function list. I'm not doing any further changes over there. So it's like you are invoking a function in the same address space. Only thing you do is you call with the client. How do I get the client? I do a gRPC dial with insecure and get the client back. The only two changes I have to make in the same client function when we are doing with the local command line argument. So I started the server over here, and we'll try to interact with it. if we do go client, right? Please specify the action you want to perform, list or add. Let's go with the list. If I do list, you can see it printed, it gave me the all what was present there, and the request come on the server as if it was the local function call itself. Nothing else we have changed. Now let's add something again. I'm adding this. I added it. If I do the list again, you see, I got all these three data. Even though it's running locally with the gRPC, you can assume that this is running in a distributed environment. So that's how the basic means. This is how the basic gRPC actually works. And this was meant to show you how to get started with the gRPC. There are lots of things that can happen with, means you can do with this. You can actually stream bi-directional streaming, or you can do client streaming and this server streaming. So just check out the doc for more information on this gRPC thing. So if you have any question, all the code for this talk is over there in the GitHub on the GitHub repo. You can find out the every talk. If you have any question, do feel free to let me know here, or if you have any doubt, do also, you can also ping me at Twitter. My Twitter handle is that. Yeah.
How are you storing those data?
It's inside the file, simple file.
Which database you are using?
I'm not storing the database, it's inside the simple file. If you look over here, person.db. So this is the simple, how you write into the simple file, right? So I am writing in local simple file, nothing else.
What if I want to use a database?
You are free to use any database. All you have to do is write your own implementation. Let's suppose on the add method. Add method, you import a Mongo client or any client and just store the same thing inside the database with your model, database schema or model. So we will be taking break for half an hour. So after that, we have the third talk by Akash. Okay, so he has just gone outside. He's from this company outside. So I don't have to worry about he has left. So we will be having a break. I think they have brought some snacks over there. So you can have the snacks. And also, if you would like to, you know, talk among them, it's just a networking session of half an hour. After that, we will have the final session. And anyone who uses, you want a JetBrain license? JetBrain license?
No.
Okay. How many of you want JetBrain license? It's a 1 year license. Huh?
Yeah, I want. Because yes, boy, it's not very good.
Hey, you have the license, right? So we basically for the speaker, we basically give it to speakers. So this year, you want it or not? So I will. So we have. I will see you in the last how many license we have this for this month. So if we get more than that number, basically you have to write your name on the cheat and God help you.
But there is a motivation that the speaker will get.
Yeah, so I do not want any license, so I can give it for my.
So you are not using JetBrains?
I'm using JetBrains, but I already have license, so I do.
Yes, or JetBrains?
See, the problem is if I show it in the JetBrains when people are just getting started, right? Oh, it's not working in the VS Code. This is just to show, means VS Code is really good. JetBrain comes into when you have a very large product. VS Code, it was little bit with Go mod. It's a little bit breaking right now, but if you are trying to get started, use VS Code. It's really good. You don't.
Actually, I think the project is very complex. VS Code does not have a.
VS Code is
fine,
actually. Yes. But
But I have found the settings which works with Go modules also with VS Code.
My name is Akash. I'm working with Kelsoft from 1.5 years now. In my previous company, I worked in Golang for 2 years. So today's talk is about introduction to memory management in Go and garbage collection. So I have two PhDs set up. First, we'll talk about memory management and then about GC. So let's get started. Okay, so this is how our program's memory looks like for Go. We have a stack a function, stack frame that we call, and we have heap. So for stack, there is some, it starts with some fixed memory, and then we can increase the memory and all. But for heap, what happens is you cannot know for sure what's the memory for it and all. As a, according to the data, it will be decided. So you may ask a question that where my variable will reside, whether on the stack or in the heap. So the question is, do you really want, does it really matter? So it does not matter if you're talking about the correctness of your, our program, but it does matter if it affects the performance. Okay?
So I think some guys are outside. Shall I bring them in?
Yeah. Yeah, sure.
This takes even if someone is not putting it, I just get this guy.
Yes. Everyone has a filled this set over here. Okay, I'm on this.
Okay, so meanwhile, how many are already aware about memory management and garbage collection in Go? This is just introductory and kind of new to me as well. So, nobody? So I forgot to mention that this is the first time I'm giving a talk in a meetup, thanks to our meetup folks as well. Thank you guys for attending. Okay, so for the folks who are joining in, what we're talking about is like this is how our memory looks like in Go. We have stack frames and we have heap. So for stacks, there is a limited amount of memory already assigned, and then it gets increased according to the data or variables that it has. For heap, there is no such thing. It does not have any specific memory. So the question we may want to ask ourselves is where my variable resides. So before that, we need to ask ourselves, does it really matter? Does it really matter where the variable resides? So it does matter in some cases and it doesn't in some other cases. So it does matter. It does not matter when we talk about correctness of our program, but it does matter when it affects the performance of our program. So when you talk about garbage collection, anything on heap will be collected by a garbage collector. So when we say GC, it maps to heap. It has nothing to do with stack. So GC is very good, but it causes latency. How it causes latency, we'll see in the next presentation. And it not just causes latency for your part which is creating garbage, but it causes latency for the full program altogether. So do you need to know? What do you need to know? It's like, if your program is not fast enough and you have benchmarks to prove it, then you need to know all this stuff. And then you those benchmarks are showing that there's excessive heap allocation. Then maybe you should look into it. Like, what are the things happening? Then you should be bothered about what is going into your heap and what is going into the stack frame. So first, most of the people say optimize for correctness, not performance. Okay, so disclaimers. whatever data we'll see, that will be like on version 1.12.4. And these are the parameters that I have used, and for showing something, inline optimizations are disabled. And I'm using println instead of FMT println. You should always use FMT println only. Another disclaimer which is not here is, this topic is like very new to me as well. So whoever knows or understands these things already, please chip in. So I have a small program. This is how I'll explain about how data goes into stack. So what this program is doing is I'm declaring a variable on line number 4, and then I'm calling a function square, which returns the square of a number, and then we are printing that. So what happens is, in the memory, a stack frame gets assigned to it, assigned to our function main on line number 4, where since compile time, we know that what are the variables for a specific function. For n and n2, addresses will be allocated. And for n2, since the calculation needs to happen yet, we will have its nil respective value. So this is what the stack frame is. So if you go to the next line, another stack frame gets created for square. And then the calculation happens for x, some address is assigned, and it has some value, initial value. So if it returns square, what happens is, now earlier this, there was no line, right? There was a line, but this line was here, this black line. What has happened is, now square function, after its execution, after the square function returning something, in the memory, it is still there, unlike some other languages. Okay, the stack for that particular function is still there. So why it is there and all, we'll look into it. But now n2 contains 16. So in Go, for a stack frame, this whole thing is a stack space, memory space, inside which we have two stack frames, func main and func square. So now what we are saying is, there is something called valid stack space, and there is something called invalid stack space. So once this square returns, it goes to invalid stack frame and it sits there. So now when we are calling println, the same stack frame will be used for println. If you'll see the address of that variable for func square and address for println will be same. That's why it keeps that frame there, because it does not want to create it again, because that will cost some time. Okay. So this was an easy example. Let's go into an example with pointer, how it will work with pointer. So what I have is, I have again a main function, n is equals to 4, and then I'm calling the increment by passing an address. And then this function just increments n's value, and which in println it should return 5. Everybody, we are on the same page, right? So again, the same thing, we have valid memory, invalid memory, and in func n is equals to 4. So in the next step, what happens is INC is called, and now we have address of n in func. So in the next step, what it does is n's value is changed, and we have this frame still with us, like in the earlier example. Then we print it, this memory gets, for func int, it's replaced by println. No surprises here. So what is happening is, sharing down typically stays on the stack. The example that we saw, it's kind of a sharing down. We have main and then it's sharing down kind of a stuff. So it still be on the stack. So in the third example, we are going to return a pointer. in earlier example, we were taking a pointer as an argument. Here we will return it. So again, a function n is equals to answer, which calls this answer directly. And then we define a variable, and then we return address of that variable. Cool? Everybody gets this, right? Okay. And then what we are doing is whatever n is there, we just divide it by 2. So our answer should be 21 at the end. So again, the same thing, funcmin, And the second thing, answer gets called. So it will get allocated here. X will be 42. Then this value, then it is pointing up, okay, this address of this will go here, and in the next step we are printing it. So println will print 21, and the previous frame, which was an invalid stack frame space, was being reused by println. So that thing is gone. But can you see the problem here, what has just happened? Because that is a big problem to us. And why, I'll tell. What has happened is, in this example, this n has address of x, which is 42, okay? And now this is invalid space for us. So what is happening is, since Go, what Go will do, it will try to see how many invalid spaces are there, invalid stack frames are there, and then it will try to reuse it. But in this case, since n requires address of this, what happens is println has this address, has this variable A21 with the same address, which was there for x. Now x is, and this n has value this one, address of x, which has become 21 now. Its value at that address become 21. So it got changed. People are getting it? Okay, cool. So that's a problem for us. So luckily, Golang does not do this. So what it does is, it escapes this thing to a heap. So what happens is, in same example, what happens is, I call this function, and now it knows that this data should go to a heap rather than residing on the stack. So at the compile time, it knows where the data will be, where my variables will reside. So who knows? The compiler knows. Then it points, and then shankidori. So in this case, sharing up typically escapes to the heap. This is kind of sharing up, right? In our previous example, this is sharing up.
So sharing down is not an issue.
No, it will remain in stack only. So what we are saying is sharing up typically escapes to the heap. Earlier I said sharing down typically stays on the stack. And who knows this? Only compiler knows this. Okay? Compiler will have that information for you. If you want to get that information, you can get it. So if you look into, this is FAQ from golang.faq, stack over here. So when possible, I'm just literally going to read this. When possible, the Golang compiler will allocate variable that are local to a function in that function stack frame. Makes sense, right? However, if compiler cannot prove that that variable will not be used after returning the function, then it needs to decide where it will go, and most it will go to the heap only, correct? So points to focus on here is when compiler cannot prove that it is not referenced after the function returns, then it will go to a heap. And again, who decides? Compiler decides. So for deciding this thing,
So why this is a question mark end of
compiler can decide. Because if it is written in a pointer, it has to go to heap because.
What I understand is that a lot of web times you have dependency injections, interfaces, you translate the data, your function does not appoint to another.
You are returning.
If you don't know who is calling, it can be injected at runtime. It can be called by interface. So the compiler might not know the exact structure hierarchy. So at that point of time, it will dependency. So if it is a one-to-one mapping, it will definitely know if the structure or the function, how it is used in the upper space. So.
After some slides, we will see an example where how compiler, not how, but in what case it will go to a heap and in what case it will not.
Okay.
So escape analysis is a key. It does some escape analysis and then it decides whether a particular variable will escape to a heap. Okay. So more FAQs. In the current compiler, if the variable has its address taken, that variable is candidate for allocation on the heap. However, a basic escape analysis recognizes some cases when such variables will not live past the return from the function and can decide on the stack. Okay, so let's ask the compiler which variables will go to a heap and which variables will reside in a stack frame. So we have used Go build more often. So this is Go help build. And point to focus on is it has a flag called GC flags, which takes a list of arguments. And what happens is when we say go build, it says go tool compile with some parameters internal. So go tool help, compile help have again a lot of parameters, but what we are interested is in M. What it is saying is print optimization decisions. This is all happening compile time. At compile time, with some flags, we'll be able to know which variables will reside in a heap and others will be in a stack frame. So using go build hyphen gc flags and then m hyphen m, you can do that. So let's see our earlier example. This stays on the stack. You can see here. That's our program. We have go build hyphen gc gc flags hyphen m and l is just disabling inline things. Okay, so we don't need to worry about that, because if I do not specify hyphen l, it will show a lot of other things. I don't want that. We are focusing on this only. So if we'll go to this line number 9, it says incx does not escape. Okay, line number 9, it says that x does not escape. And then it says that $n does not escape. Okay, just bear with me for this. And this is the example where it says it escapes to the heap. For example, save command. Now it is saying that 9, 10, that x escapes to the heap. Because at that time it does not know. Does not know in the sense, since we are returning an address. In the previous example, when we talked about the big problem, that's why it moves into a heap, this x. Getting me? So these are the things that you get, so many information about variables and stuff. So there is other option called hyphen m equals to 2, which gives more verbose output. You may want to try that. Okay, so when our value is constructed on the heap, we have seen one example of that big problem getting created. In that case, compiler doesn't know information, so it will put it into a heap. So when a value could possibly be referenced after the function that constructed the value returns, one case that we saw, when the compiler determines that a value is too large to fit on a stack, it will go to a heap. And when compiler does not know the size of the value at compile time, it will again go to a heap. So some common allocation values, this is of course non-exhaustive list, So values shared with pointers will go to a heap. Variables stored in interface variables, of course, they need to go to a heap. Then some func literal variables and this backing data examples like maps, channels, slices, and strings. Why strings? Because strings are effectively a special list byte only in Golang, right? Okay, so question for you folks is, which out of these two examples, which stays on the stack? The first or second?
Second.
Okay. Okay. The second one stays on the stack. Anybody want to elaborate on why?
Because the make is done in the
main function. And there's a spec size.
Correct. Ignore the combined amount. Yes. So in
spec size, there is there in the first function.
When you'll go to this, somewhere we said that if compiler does not know the size of things, then it will put it to a heap. That property is getting mapped here.
But size is already there in both the names.
Yeah, yeah.
The main difference is the make is done in main.
Correct. So because see, here we are passing B. So at compiler, it knows the size of B. In that case, to create B, it needs to call read first. Compiler cannot read it. So then it won't know the size of it.
No, and also like in this first example,
okay,
the memory allocation has happened on the read.
On the?
In the downstream, which has to now get used in this function. So it's like this byte. See, this is an array, right?
No. Just means with this example, nothing is done. There is nothing allocation happening on the stack. Actual allocation is happening on the heap. So the point is saying that just to say you clear this point, this is not the correct example if you want to look into. Because the slice allocation actually happened on the heap. It just is size 32 bit. So what you get is the over here is the reference to this slice. And when you pass that reference to whether in A or B, you are already passing the reference which has allocation happened on the heap. So this example is not the.
Like I said, this whole thing is new to me also.
So it's so, okay. Yeah. Just to clarify, don't take this example as the reference.
How did you come to a point where the second one is stay on the heap? Have you run this GC flex?
Yes. He saw this as the GC flag. In the GC flag, it won't come as the, if it gets escaped to the heap. Escaping is mechanism when it only escapes to heap when the actual allocation happened on the stack. Here the actual allocation already happened on the heap, so you will never find out that this has been escaped.
So that's what the thing, that by default some things will go on the heap. There are rules.
So just to add to that, like whenever you have a slice, like the backing array is always
okay. So the backing array, I understood that the metadata of the array and not the data itself. That's what making data. In the previous slide, it's making data for maps, channels, slices, and strings. So map will be having their metadata, which will be in the heap always. But the actual data may not be on the heap. That's what I understood from making data. Is it?
So in case of slice, you have a backing array and you have tenant capacity.
Okay, shall we move on? Okay. Point has to remember is we need to optimize for correctness, not for performance. And then we only put function variables on the stack if it can prove that they won't be referenced after a function is returned. And sharing down typically stays on the stack, sharing up typically skips to the heap. And we can ask compiler to find out. Don't just use this tooling. And that's it about memory management.
You have more, right?
There is one for GC.
Yeah, you can do it.
So this will be the introduction to garbage collection in Go. Again, the first thing that we saw, we have stack frame and we have heap, the memory sizes and all. So what we say is heap is not an entity. Like stack frame has a fixed size, heap does not have a fixed size. It can grow to, it can take a lot of space, and that's why garbage collection will happen in heap only and not here.
It is a fixed size.
No, to start with.
Okay.
But in heap, it doesn't work like that.
It will also have some initial size.
Yes.
Definitely will.
So.
Then it will have an incremental number.
Yes.
What I have heard is and read is initially. It is nothing, but compile time it is decided what will go to a heap, and then all those things go to a heap, and accordingly wherever whatever is there in a heap, GC will come into the picture and things will start happening.
First let's have the let him finish the talk, then if at the last we can have all the
right.
Let him finish the talk.
Sure.
It's his first talk, let him finish the talk.
Thanks. Of any memory reserve for applications in the process space is available for a heap memory allocation. So what are the duties of garbage collector are is tracking memory allocations for heap and then releasing allocations that are not that are no longer used and then keeping track of in use memory allocations. So this is from some website. So this is how, since as of Go version 1.12, Go uses a non-generational concurrent tricolor mark and sweep collector, lot of things. So this is how your heap looks like. It's like what is happening is when the garbage collector is run, these are the memory things. Earlier it started with none, then some memory and all, and then the whatever you see as a black, it's like free memory that you have. Okay. So in garbage collector, in garbage collector we have three phases: mark setup, marking, and mark termination. So if anybody is aware about STW, stop the world. So stop the world means if you have, in our case, in Golang, what happens is in many other languages in garbage collection, what happens is whatever, let's say threads that you have running at the time of garbage collection process, all those things will be in STW. But in Go, in marking stage, it will happen concurrently and it is not STW. So new memory heap allocations can happen at that time, at the time of marking, unlike some other languages. So we have three phases: mark setup, marking, and mark termination. we talk about mark setup. Let me talk about mark setup. First thing our collector does is it needs to start write barrier. So what write barrier is, we'll talk about that. But in order to start our write barrier, it needs to first stop all the go routines that are running in our application. So in this example, this is like each go structure, process, OS thread and go routine. So we have four go routines running in our application. All are up and running. So we need to stop it. So what will happen is, in stopping the world, these three go routines were stopped, but this is still running. And garbage collection's first step cannot happen unless and until all the go routines are stopped. So this will cause a delay in unless and until all the go routines are stopped. The tricky thing is, these go routines are stopped, but and garbage collector is waiting for this go routine to stop, okay, or finish execution, so that it can start its process. But if you take an example where this is not stopping, our garbage collector cannot stop this unless its execution is finished, all these three will be in a stop, and it could cause a lot of delay. So we need to understand how to write go routines or what goes into go routines. So why it is stopping is because because of such scenario, we have a lot of numbers, and what is happening is it is performing some calculation, which is causing a collector not to stop this go routine. And why is because of these reasons. So what happens is, in order to stop all the go routines, all the go routines should be in a safe state. And when these go routines will be in a safe state, when they are calling some function inside. But in our example, it is just performing some operation, and collector does not know what to do with this. So it will just wait for this go routine to finish. So that once that go routine is finished, all these things will be stopped in the stop state, and then we can move ahead. So all go routines are stopped, and in the meantime, mark setup phase is complete. So then comes the phase two, marking. So what happens in marking is, it inspects the stacks and finds the root pointers to the heap. Then it traverses to the heap graph from those root pointers, and then marks some values that are still useful. Like I said, this happens concurrently. Again, GC will have its own go routine, which needs to run this GC. So what happens is, it takes 25% of the available CPU capacity from your application only. So if you see, it has taken a space of first go routine since it is in the stop state. Since it stops everything. So with that, there is something called mark assist. So what mark assist is, it helps in finishing the collection faster. How? Goal of a collector is to eliminate the need of mark assist, but there are some times where GC does not understand, or GC is taking more time. So using mark assist, it can say that some things will be put to the next GC cycle. So there mark assist will come in the picture. Okay. So then mark assist will be again taking some other go routine, which go routine is created. Yeah, sure. So what happens is, what we are saying is, in marking state, it allows data to be put into the heap, unlike some other garbage collections. Okay. So mark assist will slow down that process. When garbage collection is happening on the heap, right? And what we are saying is in the second phase, even though garbage collection is happening, user can still put its data into the heap, new data. That was in the first stage. We had three stages.
Yeah.
So in the first stage, it is stopped.
You stop, now you start marking.
Yes.
When you stop,
no, you again, stage. You can again, in the second stage.
Second stage, it resumes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Finish. Okay, let
we will answer. Let him finish.
Okay. Okay.
We can have this discussion afterwards.
Okay.
We can continue with what
you are. Sure. So there will be MA. And in the second phase, which is marking termination, we will turn up right barrier, and then some cleanups will happen. And the it will determine the collection goal for the next cycle. So again, all the stopping will happen for all the go routines running. And then after some time, all the processes will be again up and running. Go routines will be up and running. So this is like tracking data in GC. And the next thing is swiping out or sweeping out the data, which is no longer required. So for that, it's like freeing up some heap. What we're saying is sweeping is not part of GC because it happens after GC is done. That's what we are saying. So the latency of sweeping is added to the cost of performance performing an allocation. So any new allocation that we want to perform, it will go for that. So I have an example where this is an example from some website where they have a 12 go routines running. So the first thing that I that first auto animation that we saw, something similar things will happen here. Only thing is I think it is not that visible.
Exhibit.
But I'm not sure about the clarity of the image. So it has all the things like mark assist, then GC idle dedicated and stuff. So in the next, so this is for one go routine call when garbage collection is happening. When go routine is trying to add new memory, this is how things will look. And for a specific, like when the sweep activity is happening, this is how stack trace looks like. So if you'll see these two things, next free and malloc GC. So malloc GC call is to allocate new value in the heap, and next free is causing the sweep activity. So if there are no more allocations in the heap to reclaim, you won't be seeing the next free, which we saw here. So my apologies, it's like in couple of days, why I wanted to pick this topic because I was also not aware about many things in the memory management GC. So I thought I'll also get to know and whatever it is. Thank you.
I don't think so. Most of us actually are exposed to this topic.
Okay.
So you actually bringing it up actually has given us some context.
Oh, I'm glad to hear that.
And it has opened up this forum for discussion. Otherwise, I don't think so. This is a very topic kind of not very able to pick up at the first instance. It's a very good topic. These are the topics which people have taken decades, at least 4 or 5 decades to perfect. It's not going to come up in a couple of days.
Yeah.
You can go back to the slides so that we can have a discussion.
Okay. Which one? The memory management one or GC one?
GC.
Okay.
Anybody else has questions?
Yeah, can you go to that diagram? GIF, I think there was a GIF, right? Where
okay.
The memory allocation.
Okay. I'll go.
So, Ankur was not there. The DVA context, we are uploading and for Akash for taking this topic up. It's not a very general topic which anybody takes. It's a very good topic.
Thank you, Akash.
So my question was, so whenever you're freeing memory, right?
Yeah.
So the empty spaces that are there, so the, for example, if you look at the diagram over there, the first line, there's an empty space, right?
Yeah.
Does memory allocation start over there or does it keep going down?
No. As it, if that much size is, if we need to allocate that much size, then it will be used.
So it starts from the top when it starts allocating, finds the appropriate
block. It keeps track of all the free memory and the new data coming in.
So
when new data coming in has that fixed size there, which we can add, then it will accommodate that space.
Okay.
Yes, so they may not be bothering about doing from top only, anywhere, like they need 200 bytes.
Yeah.
Whichever they have written place of 200 bytes, maybe in their programming, whatever comes first.
I recently or I don't know what this language or something like that. I don't remember. In the problem is that it does not reuse the old memory spaces if they are fragmented.
Okay.
Keeps on allocating a new memory, and they are kind of fixing it in the next one.
Yes, I think
there is no fragmentation in Go. There is no memory fragmentation in Go.
There is no memory fragmentation in Go.
So I'm so sorry, I forgot to mention one thing, that this delay that we looked upon.
I'm talking about the heap.
Yes.
So
inside.
It,
that's why there is no generational garbage collection in Go.
So the delay that we talked about, where it was waiting for that Go return to stop, in 1.14 it will be gone. That's what they're saying.
You want to add something on it on top of this?
Yeah, please.
Whatever information you have about
it. Just let me stop this. Yeah.